Good morning, everyone. Morning. Thank you, Koli, for the invitation again. So I was involved in the last year's summit for the design sprint workshop. This time is just too busy for workshop, so I'm okay with just a talk. Although I thought it's yesterday, so it's like, no, it's Monday, it's, but it's still okay. So all right, so before I'm gonna start, we only have effectively 30 minutes. I'm gonna speak about design leadership. So before we go into more heavy topic, we'll start with this very simple, I think it's more like a lighter talk, design leadership about the human itself instead of technology. Before I start, can I ask you, like, how many of you are design managers? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, okay, all right. The rest, mid-level, I suppose. All right, okay, so I want to ask the design manager or the design one or two design managers, what do you think design leadership is? Probably you can share with the audience, the design manager. What do you think design leadership is? Sorry. Who is design manager? Okay.
I think enabling your team to do the best and innovate in the best way that they possibly can.
All right. Cool. All right. Enabling the team to do the best that they can. One more. Design manager. I think I saw like so many hands, right?
Well, for me, it's to help the team to find the solution and exactly go through the project and get the finalized approval. It's the most challenge.
All right, so to find the solution and overcome all the challenges. Okay, all right, so I'm gonna start my talk. So I'm giving this title. So I'm gonna talk about like how we can drive innovation without a fancy design manager title. Because if you see, by statistic, only like from, I don't know, hundreds or 150 people, only like 5 or 6 are design managers. So you cannot just rely on managers to drive innovation. So why design leadership, right? There's so many reason why we need design leadership, but I'm just gonna share with you my own experience because you can easily search on Google the traits of design leader, good design leadership, and so on. But I think it's more valuable to share my own experience on how I think and how I do the design leadership. So this is just an example of when I was an engineer. So I used to be a software engineer in British Telecoms that time back in 2006. So 12 years ago. So we developed something that actually WhatsApp today. So we built this like 12 years ago. I think I could have been like 90 million richer. But of course, I won't be here. I will be somewhere in Maldives. But you know, like this one like is like an example of like all engineers, right? Like every engineers, we just develop what we think is cool that time. We don't know whether market is ready, or even like there's a business viability, we just develop it. And then, yes, this one is we test it, we can communicate with iPhone, that time is 2007. There's an iPhone, the first one, we can communicate with Nokia, Ericsson, so it's like basically it's all WhatsApp. You can see there's a call, chat, and everything there. So, but there's no design leader there, they're all engineers. So what I'm saying by design leader, you can see later that if I were like go back in time, I would have like tried to validate with the users and ask the business what are the business goals, what are the problems we are trying to solve, and so on. So this is just like one slide instead of $9 billion value. Again, my mind is very simplistic. I cannot think of very complicated stuff. So when you talk about design leadership, for me, it's more like how we can help the business and the product or service that we have to achieve this sweet spot. This is my favorite definition from IDEO, right? Like the innovation is the sweet spot between these three. So you have people, the desirable, that includes the wants, the needs, the pain points, the problems, also the business viability. So I've been also mentoring an active global mentor for Google Launchpad Accelerator in Silicon Valley. Whenever someone came with a very cool features or ideas, we always ask like, how would you like make money off it? Like business viability is not just, of course, not just money. But then if you talk about like startup, for example, you cannot survive unless you can monetize your product. So business is important as well. And then technical feasibility. So using all the latest technology that you have, later we'll talk about it in the afternoon or even in the evening, how would you like design that to solve your user problems and also make something that can make money? Because all of the successful innovations solve has the same one aspect. They solve problems. So if you look at like my WhatsApp version, I think we don't actually this is a problem. We just think it's cool as engineers to build it because I was in innovation a research center at that time. So design leadership is about like this tree. How do we help not just our team designers but also the business to achieve this? In reality, it's very difficult. It's very difficult to achieve this sweet spot because you have so many people, right? There's so many stakeholders. Like now, I'm with telco. I used to be always in startup. I'm now in telco and handling all the telco group under Singtel. It's even more challenging. Like so many people and so many like hierarchy, so many products. So it's even more challenging. But that's where like you need the design leadership. I'm just gonna tell you like probably like five stories, my own experience. So there are like five type companies that I've worked with. The first one is like there's a failed promising product. There's a failed company-wide user-centric movement. There's a good product that no one actually use. There's an engineering-driven company. I'm not saying it's bad, but I'll tell you why it can be improved. And there's a copycat and features or competitors driven company. It's a successful one, but it's copycat and competitors driven. So it's easier to look back and see how, as a designer, we can improve. Because my goal is to like not just, I'm sure probably the managers, they are aware of all of this process, right? But then as a mid-level designer, for example, of like a fresh graduate designers, you need to know that in my past experience, I had this title without any manager or head of design role. But then we need this kind of people who can help companies to achieve this sweet spot without being a manager. Okay, the first one is a failed promising company product. I was tempted to put the screenshot or even like the name, but then let's just use anonymous. So this product actually very way ahead of the competitors at that time. Even like it's very innovative. Even the founders and some of the team actually were relocated to US at that time. But then there's no clear product design strategy. So there's no like when you ask even like the top people, what is this all about? So where do you want to be in 6, 1, or even like 3 years or 5 years? They cannot answer that questions. So this one is something that I have improved as a designer, because now whenever I have someone, product manager, even management came, I always ask these questions like, what do you want to achieve? Where do you want to be in 6, 1, or 3 years? And you don't need to be a manager to ask these questions. Also, like there's no clear metrics to measure, because like it's very important. Surprisingly, we know in so many articles about metrics, but then so less people actually doing it. So it's very surprising when you ask like, what's the metrics? They're just like, okay, just revenue. It's very difficult, right? Like revenue is like the overall, but then how would you achieve that? You need to be able to break those very high level goals into achievable metrics. As simple as how many people actually sign up, how many people adding your e-commerce, like adding your stuff into the basket, how many people actually complete the transaction. So the kind of things is really missing in that company. And then like, it's very typical, like 1,001 features, just because, you know, like just because we can, and then you just keep adding stuff. And as a designer at that time, because I was just like very mid-level and there is no, probably I don't have this kind of sense to like challenge things. I just like keep designing without asking why we have these features or why user think this is important or something like that. And then don't talk to the users the right way. So now it has been evolved. Like we see like so many companies now have a mature researcher team, a mature even designer who can do research. At that time, it's very little. Even like the the resource to learn about research very little, 2007, I think, 2008. And then we use like so many different and wrong way to validate something. For example, like we're going to validate some usability testing, usability of product using focus group, for example. And then, you know, so there's so many wrong way to talk to the users. The other one is about the failed company-wide user-centric movement. So this is another thing that when I first got my first initial title as a UX designer, we have this like holy mission to make the company's company user-centric. So what we did, we keep talk about like design best practice. We talk about like how others are doing, and then we forget that when you talk to the stakeholders, we need to talk in their language. So their language, like business, is all about like conversion, revenue. So we don't talk in that language. Also, like no focus on building successful case studies. So this is very important as a design to when you want to promote some user-centric process within the organization. You need to like pick one features or like even like product that you can work on applying all the user-centric process, and then measure the metrics and have a successful metrics, and then bring that accessible case study, and then you can like sell UX very easily to the organization. So that's something that actually missing at the time. And then we didn't collaborate on solutioning. Well, so for example, like there's a direction to build some music service, for example. And then we just like the design team just gather in the room ourselves, and we just start designing wireframes, thinking of like what the ideas. We don't even like bring the product managers or even like the business people to the room. And hence, like it failed. So this is something that I learned a lot, especially when if you want to be the design leader, not just manager, but design leader, you need to be able to get people to be involved, not just the design team. The third one is about the good product that no one uses. So this one, just because you have excellent user experience and technology use in your product, it doesn't mean that people will use it. So again, it is back to the unclear vision of product strategy. It's different from the product strategy. Like design strategy is how, product design is how you actually have a strategy to engage users to keep using your product. How would you like design that people all the features you have? It helps to like bring people coming back to the product. Also, like there's an impulsive and reactive features addition by management, which taught me a lot how to say no now. So by default, I always say no. By default, it's really easier than you thought saying no, and people will ask why, and then you will ask why not, something like that. It's very easy, right? Like no, and then say why, and then just why not, and then you keep like why not, why not. But then it brings up a very good conversation with anyone, especially the management and the product managers, that because once you just say yes, they keep asking more, you know. So it's very good to have that kind of no, and then when they say yes, they feel like, oh yes, finally, like, you know. So you give someone some excitement. If you keep saying yes, it's very not exciting. And then another one that is a good product that someone uses that we don't understand who the users are. So this is something that actually expected as when you want to be a design leader, not manager, design leader. You can always do, I got so many message saying that, oh, we don't have resource from the management to do the research. We don't have any funding, for example. I mean, like, that's something that you can always do, right? I can always do, like, very agile guerrilla testing in a coffee shop. Even in some companies, I just pay by myself the coffee and so on. But the mentality of or the approach that you have, the mindset of always understanding your users and validating the product, it needs to be there. So there's no excuse if there's no funding. You can always recruit users through Facebook, through social. So there's so many things to do things, you know. So you cannot just say no just because you don't have fun. So that's something that also I learned to become the design leader. Another one is the engineering-driven company. So it's very typical in engineering-driven company that they just build things because they could. So again, I mentioned that just because you can, doesn't mean user will use it. And then also, like, this is one that didn't talk to the users because some engineers, of course, highly intelligent, but they always think that they are like also the users. So we are the users. And of course, whenever you always spend more time with the product, you understand more, and you just lose that first-time user's sense, you know. So you need to talk to the users. As a designer, then I start growing. I learn to like challenge the engineers and even like bring them to go to the ground to learn from the users, understand users more, and then they actually learn more about how users actually behave, that they are not the users. Also, like this is one of the things that's very important. There's no clear design principles with multiple touch points. If you have, for example, like in a telco where we have multiple touch points, so many touch points to access the same features. In many companies, they don't have like very clear design principles. Design principles is like something that you can use as a as simple as, for example, like I'm going to use a very simple, engaging, and fun design. This is something is simple. Design principles example. So it's missing actually when you ask what is design principle, you cannot, people cannot tell. And then so hence you will have some like elegant solution on the website, and then when you go to the mobile apps, it looks very fun for millennials. When you go to the EDM, the email communication, it looks like it's targeted for like the 70-year-old grandma. So if you don't have that kind of principle, it's very difficult. Hence, as a designer, it's also like your job to push this forward. The last one is about this copycat and features, competitors and driven company. So you can be successful by being a copycat and competitors driven. I'm not going to tell the name of the company. You can look at my LinkedIn. Yeah, just record it. Okay. All right. So. This is a typical one. Like you build things because competitors have them. It's very, very reactive. Like, oh, now there's an intelligent who's always look at like what competitors are doing. Oh, they have A, now let's build A, B, and let's B. For this company, I've learned quite a lot during my design career. So I learned to like challenge and ask questions like why we didn't. It's very simple. Why we need to have this feature. And then it's not just why asking questions, but also like you need to have a process where you empower people. I didn't get your name. Okay, then yeah, like empower the team to do the design, the work, right? So instead of a top down, we need to have a process where you get people to be involved in the solutioning, in not just solutioning, but also understanding the problems, which I have grown a lot. Using there's a method that my favorite is design sprint, which will get everyone in the room, and then you will have engineers, product managers, designers, researcher, marketing in the same room, trying to understand the problems, coming up with same solution, and then it will become like more like a bottom up approach instead of a top down, and then it helps the product to be better. And the last one is about the copycat. So is this a problem that also like we have in many ways? Like people, if it works for that big company, then it might work for us, something like that. So this is something that also like I always push the team, because at that stage I'm more mature in terms of like the design process. Again, back to that very simplistic definition of innovation, right? It's like the sweet spot between the users, the business viability, and the tech visibility. So instead of like asking the what should we have because computers have it, so we try to like go to the very basic foundation of asking the right problems first. Who are the users? What do they experience? Difficulties that they experience. We go to the ground. We take everyone, like the engineers, business to the ground, seeing how, observing how users use the product. And then if you want to adopt or use something that the competitors have, it is fine as long as you understand the problems. Because for one problem, you will have like 1,000 solutions, and one from the competitors can be one of the solution. So this is like 7 conclusion for those experience that I had. First, you need to challenge the product strategy, including the metrics to measure the success of the design. So challenging product strategy is as simple as asking the goal, like where do you want to be in 6, 1 or 3 months. For startups, probably 6 or 1 year, because 3 years is too long. And then it's a bottom up. So you need to like talk to the users. It needs to be driven by the user problems. Because for example, like if you want to create something that people use it a lot, users need to have this perceived failure of either they're getting the pleasure or avoiding problems. So you need to be bottom up from the users. And then you need to have like a clear user engagement strategy. Just because you have like 1,000 features doesn't mean they will use it. So you need to have like how, because each stage of the users will have different engagements strategy. Like the first time users or potential users, first time, returning, most valuable customers, they will all have different engagement study and a strategy, and you can have just like 100 features and expect them to use it without any clear engagement strategy. And then this three, the third one, also like that I cannot live without now, without collaborating. It's just difficult for me to like come up with some solution of the design without getting feedback or getting insights from the business first. And then empower the people. So for me, I always like to throw people into fire. So for example, like I just like send people, my team member, who has never experienced in design sprint, for example, to run design sprint in Indonesia, in some other countries. It's good for them to learn quickly as well, and then to get them very excited, because even if as a mid-level designer, they get very excited and empowered to come up with a solution. And then build things that matter and say no by default. So this is things that take some time to practice, especially when you are dealing with the top management, saying no. But it's like a way of you to really find out what matters to the users and find out like really the core problems of the business or the users. And then being innovative, not just copycat, because being a copycat will not take you like very far in the achievement. But if you know being innovative means that you will take that three things, the user desirability, the business viability, and tech into consideration. And then also, like I always like to this, whenever I talk to the design team, right, just aim for the moonshot. That's also good for us to like always aiming for like the best experience that we get, because in today's competition, it's very difficult. If you just like 10% better or 20% better, you need to be like 10 times better than competitors. That's something that I always encourage the team members to do so. And then also like the success breeds success means like you need to be able to have a moonshot, but then as a designer, when you want to push the design as like a standard process, or people start accepting design as like a must-have process in your product development, you need to be able to get 1 or 2 successful projects and then do your best in that project, and then bring that as a successful case study that can be used to sell your UX process. I think that's all. I'm not gonna talk too long. It's a Monday morning anyway. So we're gonna taking questions. If you have questions, just 30 minutes. Sure. So you can,
All right, thank you, Boris, for that interesting session. So this will be the Q&A part of the talk, and I believe this is the most engaging and most important part of any talk, because this is where we share, and sharing is caring. Can I get an aw for that? Aw. So let's get some questions up. Let's see, the audience wants to know, Boris, what metrics should you measure to judge if a product is successful? Great question, by the way. Who was it? Can we have a show of hand who asked that great question today? Awesome job. Okay. I will let Boris take this one.
All right. So what metrics should you measure to judge your product successful? Okay. So if you're specific talking about product design metrics, I always use, I'm sorry because I'm a Google expert, so I always use Google methods. So it's a HART framework by Google. It's HART. So it's a happiness, engagement, adoption, rate, retention and task success, HART. You can search the detail, but please make sure that whenever you talk about this during the product strategy discussion, make sure you have this written down and agreed by all the stakeholders. There's some happiness. One example is the Net Promoter Score is happiness. Engagement can be like time, or for example, if it's a video service or music, engagement means like how many songs user play in a week or in a day, how many minutes they play, this engagement. Heart adoption, if like for example you have a new feature, so how many people of the monthly active users use that new features, and then retention, the returning users, so people who have for example play one song, and then how many songs do they play in the second week, the third week, so this retention. And then task success. So for example, like how many people actually successfully created a playlist of songs that he likes, and how many people share some song, for example, to the social media. So you can have, and you should have this as a metrics, because you cannot have a very subjective. So for example, subjective means like the director say I like blue, and then you say, oh, the button should be green, and you know, like because my grandma's like the pink, something like that. That's very subjective. But then if you have this HART metrics, you can avoid that kind of very subjective discussion and have a more objective discussion.
We'll take one question up on Slido, and we have one vote on another question. So the more you vote, the more your question goes up the list. So let's
vote each other's question. So this one vote actually, right? Zero.
That's fine. It was an interesting question.
Okay.
And we'll keep one question for the floor. Okay.
Should I answer?
Sure. Okay.
Examples on how to collaborate with stakeholders. Any examples on how to collaborate? Okay, I'm going to answer this one, how to collaborate. So in collaboration, for example, whenever I want to start, let's say we want to build that music, because I'm working on something about music. So before even we build the music based on the features list by the product managers, there's a day where we call this an understanding stage, where we gather all the stakeholders at least to talk about 5 or 6 topics. So like vision and business strategy, there's a voice of the users, which is like feedback from the customer service, feedback from the research. There's a technology capacities. There's a product evolution, which is talking about how the product has been evolved for the past 1, 2, 3 years with its existing product. There's a technology talk. There's a user interview as well. So these 6 talk will be held in a day, and we'll invite like a guest speaker. So even we'll invite the CEO, we invite the head of product to talk about the vision of the product, and then we all take note of this insight. So this kind of collaboration that I usually do. And then also later, after they have all the insights, when we do the solutioning, the sketching of solutions, if it's a digital product, we'll get the product managers, the marketing to be involved in the sketching. So it's that detail of collaboration. You can learn later. So this is called the design sprint, Google Design Sprint. You can see how actually it's very highly collaborative to come up with solutions.
Okay, I think we have one burning question from the room. If we don't answer this, we will burn in hell. So let's take, how do you say no without building a reputation of being difficult to work with? How do you still make people feel you are collaborative? And after this, we'll take one question from the floor.
Okay, so the stakeholders have similar traits as the users. So they can tell what they want, but it's very difficult to articulate what they actually need. So the no is not just like no for being saying no, right? So it's no is like when they say no. So for example, like, can we have this interactive video where you can pay coins to the singer, for example, because some other application has it, and then you ask like no, and then it's like why, and then you ask like why do you want to have it, and they will say, oh, because we want to have some interaction between the listeners and the singers, and then. So what kind of, so it brings up a lot of discussion and ask more deeper questions like, so what are the business goals that you are trying to achieve? They will say, oh, because we want to monetize this, we want people to engage and buy coins, and then why do you need coins? And then they will tell you like, oh, because we want to increase the amount they spend and stuff. So then you can suggest something. So how do you become not difficult to work with? you will suggest something. You know, so when you say no and you ask questions and you find that, oh, this is actually like the core problems or the core goals that they don't want, then suggest something. The suggestion might not be the solution itself, but you can suggest something like, okay, let's find out. Let's go to the ground and ask people around and then ask, get insights. And then if people say that this feature is actually something that they need, then okay, let's build it. So that's something how you can, so by being, by conversation. So it's you won't be seen as being difficult. And then how do you still make people feel, yes, so by make assertions and then get them to together to find out if this is really like the real user needs. Okay, I think hopefully that answered the questions, Mike. Yeah. Okay. All right. So.
Okay. Can we have one question from the floor? Anyone? Otherwise, I will pick you. We'll come down the room and I'll hunt you. I need one question from back of the room. Okay. I have one question for you, Boris.
Sure.
What would you tell your younger self when you were just starting out your career? If you had to go back and give maybe one piece of advice for all the young managers out here.
You should have sent me this message before, right? I think that's just being bold and challenge assumptions. I think it's something that I always tell myself. So being bold and challenge assumptions, because in my, I think my younger time, I don't challenge. Especially when it's like a higher or top management, I don't challenge them. So that's something that I think we should learn to challenge. Yeah.
As a UX consultant to a company where they're not aware of UX processes, design sprints, for example, or design workshops, the first question they say is, we hired you to do this. Why are you making us do this? How to address this?
Right, so the design collaboration also depends on, for example, like if you're dealing with the clients, right? So for example, like in many cases, probably you just want to limit the solutioning to yourselves, but then at least they get involved in the early stage where you want to find out the core problems, because they need to tell you the problems, right? They need to like be able to tell you the business goals, the problems, and if, for example, you want to get them to go through like workshop, co-creation, and so on. If they don't want to do it, then just screw it. Okay, they just do it. But then you need to like at least get them to agree on the business goals and the users first. Like, who are the users? What problems are you trying to solve? And agree on the metrics, because that's very important. Because once if you don't have the metrics, it's very difficult to justify a design. Let's say you have a music player and you put the button on the middle, for example, and they say, oh, I think it should be at the top because I like it at the top. But then you will say that, oh, just because we're going to drive users to this and based on this perspective, then that's why you put it there. So it's more like constructive discussion if you have a metrics. So at least get them to come to discuss on the business goals, what are their vision, because it's their product. So you need to like cater for their vision and then ask them who are the users and then just do your magic. Yeah. So you need to be able to like see the maturity of the company. Because sometimes you don't want to get them involved too much as well, because they might like give you like a very bad direction of the design. So it's like you intentionally didn't get them to be involved. So something like something. Yeah. All right.
Okay.
I think there's one more that I think pretty interesting to answer. Like,
I think that's
it.
Just all the time we have. So be bold, take challenges, screw it, and just do it. Truer words haven't been spoken. Thank you, Boris. Let's give a round of applause.